My organization is working on this issue already for a long time. I started myself, as Vera told, in the field of peace building, conflict transformation, human rights and development. And for the last 10 years, we found it more and more difficult to engage in different parts of the world on issues of security. And mostly because for civil society, it's not easy to step on board. I will go into that during my presentation, but just to give a quick kickoff, civil society is often seen as just a sector, and governments do not have the proper understanding of all the differences in civil society in order to make civil society a good partner. And when it comes to the problem of violent extremism and terrorism, it becomes even more difficult because it's often, very often, politicized. There's not a real level playing field between the hard security and civil society in terms of information streams, in terms of trust. And most of the time, also civil society, from their side, they don't really trust governments and especially hard security side to step into a collaboration. So let me try, and I was very grateful, OC, that they asked me to elaborate on some of the examples that I've been working on and still work on, and not only in my own country, the Netherlands, but also in Africa and on a global program. So my work is mostly in the Sahel region, it's in Tunisia, it is in Europe, and in Latin America, although in Latin America the problem of violent extremism is in a really different way. I hope the translation is okay. If things are not clear, please let me know, because it's a very interactive panel. Let me start with just a little bit of my own understanding and share that with you, that if we talk about countering violent extremism, we have to look at different levels of what we actually mean, and just take in mind the pyramid that I've drafted there. And if you go to the top level, we see the counter-terrorism. That's the top of the issue. Counter-terrorism is very different from countering violent extremism. Why? Because it's based on hard security. It's based on exclusion. It's based on a targeted approach. That means that you identify the problem, you criminalize the problem, you list people or organizations, you isolate them by laws, by freezing assets, by mobility, by taking passports. And then you try to give follow-up within the boundaries of the rule of law. This is an approach that is not preventive in itself, but it's an approach that's very necessary when terrorism is at stake. So I want to put that on the top. After, let's say, the last decade, when we had a lot of new laws and measures worldwide on countering terrorism, in the end of the decade, we slowly heard more about a softer approach, which was more inclusive. And that was called countering violent extremism. So then slowly violent extremism turned instead of terrorism. But there's a big difference. This is a complete other way of understanding and working. Why? Well, if we go to the middle level and we say, well, after countering terrorism comes countering violent extremism, I called it a 1.0 edit. It's a very specific way of working on violent extremism. It means that you are using a more inclusive way. So instead of working only with the hard security parts of government, the military, the police, the intelligence and judges, also here you try to involve other ministries, education, health, for instance, development, ministries of religion. So it becomes like a softer approach that includes also the softer departments within government to make the whole government responsible for problem of violent extremism. And when you work on a community level, you try to target the problem. So you look at, for instance, youth that are at risk, and you try to target them with counter-narrative. You look at the approaches, you look at the internet. It's a very CVE-specific approach. When that was introduced, you very quickly had the discussion on, is this approach broad enough to bring in all players that can play a role in preventing violent extremism? If we talk about human rights, if we talk about development, if we talk about huge part of society that are unemployed, you need to work on the development side. So do you bring in also other aspects than only very specific violent extremism aspect? That was the question. So then we come to the lowest layer, which is called, I call it the CVE 2.0, and today in the UN, it is called the PVE, the Prevention of Violent Extremism. And that's a very impressive and very important part, because there it is mostly inclusive. It is based on a human security approach, so not only on security on a state level, but you go into communities and you try to find out what is security about here, what are the different agendas. It is a long-term process. And how can you get communities in, especially communities where the risk is, communities that are at risk, where recruitment takes place, where attacks take place. So it becomes from a whole of government, it becomes a whole of society approach. And I think that's exactly the moment where we are, and that's the discussion that we have, not only here in Bosnia, Herzegovina, but we also find that in many other places, where all kind of different players come around the table and try to identify what is actually the problem. We're not talking anymore about terrorism. We're talking here about a much broader things that had root causes, basic grievances in various other aspects. So I just wanted to share that picture with you, because if we want to work on how to engage with community, how to create partnerships with community, you should at least understand about what level are we talking about. And if we talk about the top level, it's probably harder to imagine how communities can work together and civil society and NGOs than when we talk about the lowest level here in this picture, because there are plenty, a myriad of possibilities to do that. What is problematic if we talk about civil society is that civil society is not one sector. The people here who work in civil society, who are from civil society, might understand my problem. There are so many different organizations, there are so many different understandings of civil society. Communities, community-based organizations, international organizations, think tanks. What are we actually talking about if we want to step out and make them partner? So also for governments, it's good to understand what is a civil society picture. So I try to define that in a very simple way. I said, well, at least we have to understand two dimensions. One dimension is the big, let's say, continuum between, on one side, if you go completely to the left side of this picture, service and content driven. And on the other side, value or ideology driven. Both you find in civil society, but both are very different. So you have NGOs, you have community-based organizations that can be mainly providing services, but also you can have them based on values, based on ideology, based on religion. It can be together, but mostly you find or one or the other. And of course, it's important to understand at what level are they working. Do they work on a very local level, grassroots, as we call that, or do they work on higher levels, national, in the capitals, do they work internationally? Well, try to fill out this picture. In the top level, we could say that on the left side, service and content-driven, international, probably think tanks, knowledge centers, research institutes, sometimes institutes very close to universities or to investigation. In the middle, we find the bigger INGOs, so the big development organizations. They provide services, humanitarian services, social services, but at the other end, they are based on their humanitarian values and ethics. And if we go more to the right side, you find the global movements, and today we have many, many global movements on climate, on security, on cyber, on religion, any topic, on media, you find global movements. And then it's very important to understand what are the basic values and what is the ideology that is driving and combining this movement. If you go down to this picture, to the more local level, we could say, well, on the left side are the typical care providers and social care providers at community level. We know them all. So the small voluntary organizations or the NGOs that provide certain cares in the social area, in the human rights area, in information area, but also in security areas you find them. So when you go a little bit more to the center, the peace building organizations, community security initiatives that we were talking about yesterday in this group. And if you go more to the right side, you find the community-based interest groups, so groups that are specifically working from their own interest. You can have women groups at local level, youth groups, student groups, farmer groups, credit groups, all kind of groups that protect their interests and create an organization around it. And then on the most extreme level, we have the grassroots movements, people that create a movement at the very local. And let's not exclude the religious networks that are, on one hand, completely value and ideology driven and working internationally, but also reaching out to the very, very local, and they are able to combine the both levels. Interesting enough, when we make the step to countering violent extremism, is that the most important part to reach out to is the part in red. Why? Because those are the parts in society where people live, where communities take place, where the dynamics of recruitment take place. So if we want to work with civil society writ large, we have to reach out to communities, community-based organizations, grassroots organizations, religious organizations that are really in communities. And that is a little bit complex because mostly these organizations are very informal. They have a low organizational capacity, so they're not the easiest to talk with or to negotiate with. And there's also a legitimacy issue. And I'm not very, very familiar with the laws in Bosnia, but I know from other countries that a lot of the restrictive laws from the past have been especially on organizations that are working and living in the community level, because there's the biggest risk. So they are or under surveillance, or they have a financial problem to receive any support from other outsiders, or the freedom of association can be at stake there, because gathering together around issues might also be very suspicious. So here we have an issue to deal with, and it's always good to go into a local context to find out what are the organizations there and what is it that we can do together. So I put it in big letters. If you look at the left side, you see contracting in red. Why did I say contracting? Well, if you want to work together with the left area of the screen, mostly you see it's a process of contracting civil society. So government can write out tenders, they can ask for proposals, they can contract them to provide services, and that's what's happening. Which is good on one side, it's an easy process, but that doesn't mean that you can do the same approach contracting on the right side of this picture. Why? Well, very simply, because if you are value-driven as an organization, you are not going to give in on your values. So if you talk about security and provision of security, it's a very value-driven aspect. So if you want to work together with organizations on that side, you have to negotiate and you have to dialogue with them, which is very often, I found myself in governments, a difficult thing to do because you have your government policy and you cannot dialogue or negotiate about that. But that's one of the things we see in the world and we try to do, and I think my neighbor might give some very important aspect from the police, from the Mounted Police in Canada, and I will give you some insights as well, how you can try to work on the negotiation and a dialogue with civil society in order to make them part of it. So a kind of 0-0-1-0 approach here, it's contracting or dialoguing. Of course, there are many different levels within that. And then before I go into the examples, when you engage with civil society, it is not just a one-step process. It's a very slow, long-term process, and you start on various levels. And the deeper you go, the more impact you will have. So the more intensive your relationship will be with communities, with civil society organizations, the more impact you can have. And if you go from the lowest to the highest, of course, you start always with informing. So as governments and as NGOs to your own constituency, you should start with informing what is your policy, what is the problem, what are the threats, what are you talking about. And you also, the next step is to console them, try to bring them in, listen to them, hear them, what is their analysis, and then make them involved in it. So give them little parts of the action. And when that works, collaboration can start place. And the highest degree of partnership, of course, is empowerment. Give them the tools to do it. And I've seen some very successful collaborations between governments and civil society where they define the threat on a common level and government empowers civil society to do the job of prevention in the way that they think is best. But I put it as the highest one. Well, that's just like an introduction, just to make sure that there's a little bit more understanding of what do we mean of civil society and what do we mean by engagement. And I would like to go quickly, because I think my time might run out, into three examples of things that I've been living, I'm working on. One is the soft approach in Nigeria in how to counter Boko Haram. The second one is how to involve civil society in the issue of terrorism financing. And the last one is how to prevent foreign terrorist fighters in the city of Delft, the city where I was born and raised, and I'm working there also on a prevention program. Let's go to Nigeria very quickly. Why do I take Nigeria? Well, Nigeria is an interesting country because it has a very, very specific threat, Boko Haram. You might have heard about them. It is not easy to defeat the terrorism in Nigeria. There are many political reasons for that, and there are many technical reasons for that. A few years ago, the National Security Advisor started to introduce a soft approach. Why? Because they acknowledged that by military options and police options, they never could defeat Boko Haram. So they said, well, we have a soft approach, but that means that if we want to work on that approach, if we really want to stop Boko Haram, we have to work with the communities in the areas where Boko Haram is active and the communities where they recruit, especially the young men and young girls. Well, we all know that recruitment by Boko Haram is not anymore by inspiration, but now by force, abduction, and other forms of force. So that created an atmosphere in which civil society and government kind of understood the threat very quickly in a common way. And we said, well, if we want to work to roll out this soft approach into the north part of Nigeria, we should start to invite civil society and listen to them and listen to their soft approach. What is their preventive approach? And mind you, soft doesn't mean that it's soft. It can be especially very hard, but soft is, it's preventive. You don't take a coercive measure. It's not by arms and guns. So soft means dialogue is in the center, education, interreligious dialogue. You involve people, you listen to them, you work on employment issues, etc. So what we did over the last 2 years is to invite every step a bigger group of NGOs. And today there's a group of 50 NGOs that is coming together every 3-4 months in the capital, sitting with the government and talking about the approach. What should we do? What are the projects within it? How do we relate to religious leaders? How do we relate to youth? How do we change the curriculum in education, on schools, on high schools, primary schools, basic schools? And how do we create an early warning mechanism together? So if we see some radicalization issues coming up, if we see the recruitment of some young boys and girls in some areas, if we hear things about attacks, how are we going to bring that together from civil society into a mechanism that is not directly completely responsive and restrictive, but that works directly on the ground? And I might say, although Boko Haram is still there, the network that's called PAVE, the Partnership Against Violent Extremism, is very active and is now outstanding in terms of tackling this problem. I just wanted to share with you, because I think it's one of the good examples how government and civil society can start to work together, although there's no trust at the beginning, but the exercise on itself is trust building, it's conflict resolution in itself. The discussions are not easy, but they take place. That's the first. Then the other one, it's a more technical one. It's about terrorism financing. And I can talk days about this, but I try to do it in just 3 minutes. The Financial Action Task Force, the FATF, that's based in Paris, 198 countries are related to this, so almost the whole world. They set recommendations for governments, especially the Ministry of Finance and the legal part, to counter money laundering and terrorism financing. So they set recommendations, try to stop money laundering and terrorism financing. And in one of the recommendations, that recommendation 8, that says very clearly, that states clearly, that governments are asked to regulate the not-for-profit sector, which are the NGOs, which is civil society, which are the charities, because there's a risk that not-for-profits, NGOs, are abused by terrorists. There's a risk that terrorists use charities, NGOs, to finance terrorist activities. Whether there's evidence for it or not, that doesn't matter. This recommendation is sent out, and this has led to a lot of regulation to restrict the financing of civil society, which is good when it's civil society truly at risk, but which is not good when civil society is not able to function as it should, as I just mentioned before. So what we saw is that a lot of counterproductiveness came in the regulation. So we started to get civil society together worldwide in the United States, in Europe, in Africa, in Asia, and start to talk about what is really going on in terrorism financing. And we, civil society as a sector, we also want to sort out the risk of being financed by terrorists or abused by terrorists. So that's fine with us. But we want to do it in such a way that it's really effective, not that it's only restrictive, so that we are not able to receive funds from other countries, that we're not able to come together, that we are not able to do the work that civil society should do. So that means that you have to come up with counter-evidence about threats, that you have to come up with measures how to regulate your own sector from within, not done by government only, and how you can work together with government, with the Ministry of Finance, with the regulators, but also with the banking sector, because the banks are very important here. They have to regulate NGOs. If I transfer money from The Hague, where I live, to Sarajevo, probably five banks will do a due diligence process to find out if the final destination is not meant for terrorism. And if there's any suspicion, no way that I can transfer my money. So that has become more and more difficult. So not always productively. So we try to go back with them and sit together in a multi-stakeholder process. And today I might say that this had led to increased transparency in money flows, daily communications with the FATF, increased trust between the different parties, and improved regulation and assessment in various countries where we did not expect that. So just in a few words, this is an issue where civil society and security sector can work together. Then last but not least, my own city of Delft. I don't know if anybody of you ever have heard about Delft. It's close to The Hague. It's a lovely, beautiful city. It's very small, the best technical university of the Netherlands and maybe Europe, but I don't know if I'm allowed to say that, it's based there. Strange thing about the city is the highest recruitment place for young, mostly young boys, but also a lot of girls going to Syria, going to join ISIS. So we ask ourselves, what is going on here? Why, especially in this small town where everybody knows each other? And who are these foreign fighters? And how did their radicalization process evolve? But then you have to go into a little bit of the background of this city. And Delft is like a very double society. There's an elite community around the technical university, researchers, investigators, professors, students, who have the best jobs and who have the best, let's say, opportunities in life. And there's a big group of people who don't have that. There's a relatively large number of social housing projects where large families live in the big flats. Many of these families are from foreign asylum seekers, families that came into Delft already 30 years, 20 years ago, 10 years ago. And their children, first, second generation, third generation, or even fourth generation, are the children that are at risk now. And very strangely, but this city has always been the biggest hub for criminal networks. So you see here that the criminal networks, they have a kind of a breeding place in Delft, and that's linking up with the recruitment networks for ISIS or Daesh. So what we said there, and we tried to work this problem out with not only the social sector, but also with the police and the repressive sector. And I think that because the city was very small, it was easy to sit together, try to identify all the actors, and try to work on the safety chain, as I just put it in a few simple words. You work on all the issues at the same time. So you're proactive. You try to visualize what can be the problem tomorrow. You work on the prevention aspects. You do preparation in case some risk might happen tomorrow. You need repressive measures, so you need law enforcers to step in and be part of that. And you need to do aftercare. What happens after people come back from Syria? And some came back. What happens if they come out of jail? What happened if you really prevented a radicalization process within some families or some youth? What are you going to do with them? You don't leave them alone. So this safety chain, simple but effective, worked well in Delft. And why? I think because we were able to combine repression and prevention in one team. So sitting together with all partners in society, have the police there, have intelligence people there, have fathers and mothers there who really felt an issue, have teachers in the group, social workers, NGOs that could provide technical assistance, for instance, in de-radicalization process. Work also with religious leaders from both Christian and Muslim side. And let every partner take a responsibility in this chain. The interesting thing is, as soon as you start to talk, you come at a level that you identify a common threat. Because if you don't have a common threat, there's no way that you're going to work on this chain together. So you need to identify a common understanding of security altogether, which is not the security only of the city, of the national security. It's not the security only of a family, but it's a shared security between families, schools, shopping centers, churches, mosque, and the city. So the creation of a common knowledge of security is very important here. And try to involve the right persons to make a personal plan, sometimes repressive and other times repressive. Well, that is just in a very few words. And I think what we learned from Delft, and we're not ready yet, I mean, this process has actually just started, is that if we try to work on an equal or let's say a level playing field between civil society organizations, the big variety, and the law enforcers, preventive and hard security of government, it's a long-term process. It's a trust-building process. It's a continuous dialogue and negotiation about what are our roles, what are our stakes, what are the conditions that we bring in information, how do we do it. So it's never finished. It's a continuous dialogue. But as soon as you can bring this into a governmental situation that reaches out to civil society, I think many good conditions and many good examples of how it could work around the issue of violent extremism.